Blizzard and Facebook team up to take on Twitch. Cortana is moving into your living room, and who wants to buy some human gills? All that and more on Tech News Today.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for Tech News Today is provided by CashFly at CACHEFLY.com.
This is Tech News Today, episode 1528, recorded Monday, June 6th, 2016.
This episode of Tech News Today is brought to you by Trunk Club. Get clothes that fit and look amazing without ever stepping into a store again. Trunk Club will help you create the wardrobe you've always dreamed of with your own personal stylist. Go to trunkclub.com/TNT and join Trunk Club today.
And by Blue Apron. Blue Apron will send you fresh, high-quality ingredients to cook delicious meals with simple step-by-step instructions right to your door. See what's on the menu this week and get your first two meals free with free shipping by going to blueapron.com/twit. That's blueapron.com/twit.
And by PillPack, a full-service online pharmacy that combines modern technology, convenient packaging, and personalized service to make your life easier. Visit pillpack.com/twit to save $20 on vitamins and OTCs when you transfer your prescriptions. Hello and welcome to Tech News Today. This is a show where we talk about all the technology news with people who are passionate about technology. I am Megan Morrone.
And I'm Jason Howell, trying to get into the Monday groove, all that sort of stuff. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry if I'm a little tired.
Do you need a nap?
I might need a nap.
This. I can take this.
Okay. Well, there's a pillow down there, so I might just like crawl up down there if need be. But it's okay, just for a story, and then I'll be right back up for the next one. Mm-hmm. Joining us today is Jill Duffy from PCMag.com. How's it going, Jill?
Pretty good. How are you guys?
We're doing awesome. Not bringing you in from India this time. This time it's New York. So it's only 3 hour difference.
I'm back on my home turf for a little while. Yeah. So visiting New York for the month of June and then back to India, where I have met quite a few Twit listeners out there.
Oh, really?
Oh. Yeah. A lot of fans in India.
Oh, that's awesome. That's so cool.
So what wearable are you sporting these days?
I have the new Garmin Forerunner 735 XT, which is a triathlon watch. Here, I'll do it that way. That's a little better.
Okay.
Heart rate monitor on the back. Very cool. Easy transitions between all three sports. Lots of other features, push notifications, things like that. And then I have the lovely Misfit Ray, which is very simple, but it's super elegant. And I really give Misfit a big hand for creating something that actually looks lovely to wear with just about anything.
Misfit Ray, I've never heard of that one before. What exactly is it? Oh, well, there we go. Fitness and sleep monitor.
Yep, it's an activity tracker and sleep monitor. It's pretty basic. It has an indicator light on it. It flashes and vibrates when you get push notifications from your phone. But I really just love the style. It comes with a whole bunch of accessories. You can slip it onto a necklace chain or change the band. It's waterproof. You can swim with it. It's really lovely.
Nice.
Yeah, I like how you always, one is not enough. One wearable is not enough for you. So it's nice that they made them, you know, slender and nice. So, yeah. And I've been looking at that Garmin. Garmin makes great products for athletes. So
they do. Yeah, there's some really great stuff on this one where you can get advanced data if you're into, like, your VO2 max or your lactic acid threshold. If those are words you don't understand, you don't need to spend $500 on this watch.
All right, well, let's get to today's news. If you like watching other people play Overwatch or Hearthstone or World of Warcraft and other Blizzard games, you are in luck. Soon it will be easier than ever. Blizzard Entertainment announced today that it will soon use Facebook's live streaming API to allow gamers to log into the PC games with Facebook's API and then stream their gameplay live on their Facebook feed. So this is sort of a slam on Twitch, like a big competitor to Twitch. And just also, I feel like this is going to bring a lot of people, introduce Overwatch and other big games to a lot of people like that are on the Facebook, because as we know, lots of people use Facebook. So they're going to be able to see this in other people's streams. What do you think about this, Jill?
I have to admit, I've never been a fan of Twitch or any of these kind of networks that allow you to watch other people play video games. It's something I did in college really out of boredom, and it's just so foreign to me. I can understand that other people like it, appreciate it, want to do it. Putting it on Facebook is interesting because I think it's going to hit a very specific market. And I'm wondering if they're not hitting that market hard enough right now. So I'm curious if Facebook is having a hard time capturing the market of people who are in the demographic that they would want to play games and watch other people play games and know what other people were playing. If that's an area of weakness right now for them, and this is part of why they're going to offer it. I also think that Facebook is trying very hard to get into the live streaming game, and they're a little late to the party, I think.
Well, that's interesting, because are you making the point that, you know, we all only have a certain amount of downtime, and, you know, some of us are spending it scrolling through Facebook, and others of us are spending it playing Overwatch, and so to combine those two would be, you know, who has the time to do both, sort of
thing? Ultimate time suck.
Yeah, well, doesn't it also sort of change the nature of Facebook if you're then sitting on somebody's page or feed or post for 15, 20 minutes at a time as opposed to scrolling and looking and jumping around?
Yeah, and I think there the key is Facebook's magical algorithm, right? There are people, like, I'm a game enthusiast, but I don't really sit down to watch people play games. But I can appreciate it because I've definitely done that in the past. But now in my life, that's not a priority. So, and there are a lot of people that feel vehemently opposed, you know, like, what on earth is this doing in my feed? Like, I would never sit down and watch this. So if Facebook's algorithm is good enough, and I'm sure that it is underneath the hood, to make sure that only the right people see that kind of streaming content, maybe, you know, somebody who's put a lot of gaming content into their feed already, and that would be a signal to Facebook to be like, oh, well, this friend of that person is streaming their gameplay, recognize it and offer it up to them in their feed, then maybe it wouldn't be as big a deal. But if, you know, long playing video, you know, live streaming video games are appearing in every single person's feed, I can imagine a lot of people kind of just wondering what the fit is there. Mm-hmm. And why they're seeing that.
I think that Facebook's gotten, their algorithm has gotten a lot better since the days when it was like we were always, you know, getting alerts that so-and-so wants you to play whatever game. And, you know, they don't do that anymore if you don't respond to it anymore. So I agree that I don't think we're going to be seeing a lot of this if we really don't want to. But I think this is just joining the community of people that want to watch video games with Facebook is just crazy to me. Because, I mean, that community is huge. And right now I'm in Twitch is owned by Amazon. So, you know, it's just another way that Facebook is getting bigger and taking over more of the world.
Which was always their ambition, was yes, to not just be a social network, but to be much larger than that. Yeah, I mean, this is great for Blizzard, right? Like you were saying, just the amount of, because it's using Facebook login under the hood, you know, someone going in to play a Blizzard game, they're immediately going to see on that vast social network of 1.5 or however many billion users, how many of their friends are logged in and using it right now, and they automatically know of their friends who they can play with. And that's a great thing. Mm-hmm. We're talking about community and gaming and all that. So it's very cool stuff. The living room is obviously becoming a big battleground for voice assistants. A few weeks back, we talked about how Apple might be working to bring Siri to the Apple TV. And today, Microsoft announced a new Xbox One update rolling out to preview members only at this point anyways, that includes Cortana. Access to Cortana will appear in the Xbox One dashboard and through the voice assistant using the Kinect, as was required before, but also using a headset so more users can get in on the voice action. I think that comes later this summer. Users with the update will now say, "Hey Cortana," instead of saying Xbox followed by a command. So Xbox turn on, you know, on or whatever the command was. Now it's just meant to be a little bit more of a conversational flow type thing. And I think when you're talking about voice assistants and voice entry and commands and all that kind of stuff, the more conversational, the better, especially when you're in your living room, I suppose. I don't know. What do you think, Jill? Is this whole living room kind of trend the next big frontier for voice assistants? And
I think what you're kind of glossing over is that from what I understand, the source that Xbox is using is actually going to change to become the Cortana source. And I'm not sure if they're the same or if they have overlap right now. But it sounds like from what I was reading that this change is going to give you access to the Cortana system through Xbox, right? So that's a little bit different. And what I'm hearing from that is Cortana is probably better at whatever this other system is baked inside Xbox, right? I think the other thing that Microsoft probably has picked up on is that people who are playing games and using their Xbox are the ones who are using voice activation heavily, and that users of their other devices, so, you know, people on Windows phones and Windows PCs, are probably not using it as much. So Microsoft probably said, I'm guessing, we developed this really wonderful voice processing system, and we're not giving it to the people who are actually using voice commands, so let's give it to them. So I have a hunch that that's probably what's behind it all. But that's good. That's good for Microsoft to recognize it and see that that is where people are using voice commands. This is something that I've been thinking a lot about ever since the new wave of voice assistant technology sort of came into our lives about 4 years ago, with Siri in particular, is that there's a sociological aspect to it. So do you want to be seen walking around the street talking to a computer? A lot of people still say no. If it's in your living room and you're with your kids or you're alone, maybe that's a more comfortable environment. When you're in your car and you're by yourself and it's more dangerous to take your hands away from things and take your eyes away from the road, then it makes sense. So it's all about figuring out not only who's using it, but why. Like, what are the sociological conditions under which voice activation makes sense? So this is, I think, what other purveyors in that space should be paying attention to is that Microsoft has a lot of data on this kind of stuff. And I think they're keying into this space, the living room space, as you sort of said, Jason, as being like a key place where it makes sense and people want to use it.
Mm-hmm. So are you saying that I know that gamers, there are more people using Xbox than there are Windows phones. But also when you're gaming, you're also often, you have a headset, you're talking to people already. So are you saying that it's something that people are already comfortable with, just speaking? I mean, there in the past have been mostly, I mean, you can speak to the Xbox now, but you can also speak to people. So people are already used to just talking to someone that isn't there, whether it be Cortana or another gamer?
I think that's part of it, but I think the living room as a space is, or the home as a space is really most important. So if we think about, for example, the competition that's going to be felt because of Amazon Echo, that's another device that uses voice activation, but it lives specifically in the home, and it seems to make sense there. So it's not necessarily the microphone, I don't think.
Well, I mean, that's what I wondered about this, because they said, you know, we've talked about Apple coming up with a new device, a new sort of Amazon Echo competitor. And a lot of people have said it's going to be Apple TV. That's what, you know, and we're already talking. I have an Apple TV. I talk to Siri, but I'm not that comfortable with it. You know, like you're saying, like, I'm just not used to talking to my remote. And but it is smarter. It's I'm getting used to it and getting better because I'm asking it a limited amount of things. I'm asking it only about television and apps and the things I do on Apple TV, nothing else. So it's very smart versus Siri, not so smart because it's everything. It's tons of languages. You know, Siri has to do a lot, so she's going to fail most of the time.
Yeah, when I talk to people who use the Amazon Echo and I say, what do you do with it? What do you want it to do? In which circumstances do you use it? A lot of people say, in the kitchen when my hands are dirty. Mm-hmm. Like, that's when they call upon it. Or while I'm holding and nursing a baby and I can't use my hands anymore. So it's a very specific context. So if you think about gaming, for example, you have your hands already on a controller, perhaps, right? Like, you're in the middle of doing something else that prevents you from accessing that control system in another way. So if you're playing a game and you want to, like, pause it quickly, or you want to invite somebody else to play, or whatever it is, like, there's this very specific context and a reason. I think that's what all of these companies are trying to do and make work. And I think the mobile phone is an interesting place for voice activation, because there don't seem to be as many situations and contexts in which it makes sense as there are when you're doing something else in the home and there's a device not near you and you need it to, like, recognize your voice instantly, et cetera, et cetera.
Yeah. So often, you know, they
the utility of it being on your phone, you know, is kind of shattered by the fact that it's already in your hand. And, you know, right. many times, like, that's good enough. All it takes is a single tap to do the thing that maybe you don't want to have to use your voice and, oh, didn't catch it, do it again, and hope that it works at some point. It ends up being more trouble than it's worth, but in the home, it's better. And then also, we've also heard that there might be more media-capable Xbox One, kind of like stripped down Xbox One versions being shown off as soon as next week at E3. So it's possible that maybe there's some sort of hooks for this into that. And maybe that's why we're hearing about it now. So that's like the perfect lead up into the new device if it's shown off.
Well, this leads right into our next topic, AI, which obviously voice recognition is an important part of that. The Wall Street Journal reports that Dan Golden, the former head of NASA, has been working on a new artificial intelligence project. He's been working on it for the last decade. It was announced today, New Edge, that's with a K, is a neurobiology project covering everything from advanced voice recognition to machine learning. New Edge promises to create tech that will alter how humans interact with machines using chips that act and work like the human brain. So this is a little bit about what we were just talking about, Jill. What do you make of New Edge?
I'm so excited about this story. I really am. So what I'm excited about is somebody is taking on this project that is not a quick moneymaker. And that's one of the problems that we see in tech. People need to get funding quickly, and they need to turn out a piece of software or a piece of hardware that they can sell at a high value to get their money back and give it back to their investors. It's very difficult to embark on a technological project that's gonna take you 10 or 15 years. So when I heard that he's been working on this for 10 years in secret, I was just so excited because you don't see that kind of dedication from a lot of people. But the former head of NASA clearly has the know-how, the connections, and probably the money to get something like this started. I think he was able to raise a couple million dollars from friends and other investors, although it sounded like most of the investors were friends, to help him along with this project. And it's really getting into reinventing chips in a lot of ways. So this is something super difficult. Nobody wants to do. It's a huge investment. And I love that somebody said, no. There are huge gains to be made here, so let's go for it. And okay, so the huge gains are the idea of like multi-core processing, I think. Mm-hmm. So his understanding is that the human brain is capable of parallel processing like somewhere in like the 10,000 range or something. Like our brains are so sophisticated and can do so many things at once. So we have, automated responses. We can talk and breathe at the same time. We can walk around and look at something and pay attention to what we're hearing and also eat. You know, like we could just do so much at once. And there's something to be learned from the way our neurobiology works that we could bring into computing. So when he says AI, I don't think he's really talking about like, let's make a robot that can speak like a human. But he's actually talking about like replicating the way our brains physically work. And that's just so exciting. So exciting to see somebody like try to make a leap from scratch rather than building on the technology that we have.
Yeah, and that we've been using for so long that has its own bottlenecks on being able to be capable enough to do this kind of next step, which you kind of have, at least I've always kind of assumed, and I imagine anyone that follows computing has assumed that's kind of the end game, right? Is to build a system that's as complicated as the human brain and can do all the things, and then I imagine beyond that, if possible. This is 256 cores, so on one single chip. And that allows the Lambda fabric, to connect to upwards of 512,000 devices with, 400 nanosecond latency. So just, it's insane. And I love the longevity, the kind of the long-term process, like you were saying, Jill. 10 years in the making with investors that just kind of knew this was not going to be a short-term thing. It was going to take some time to be able to pull something off, like this off. And here we are 10 years later, nobody knew about it, but I have a feeling we're going to be hearing a lot more about this.
I think it is so interesting that he comes from NASA. He was at NASA from 1992 to 2001. I mean, if you think about the way they did technology at that time, I mean, it's very different, like you said, Jill, very different than the way Silicon Valley works, where, you know, we know all the investors here. I don't think we know. I think they were all unknown angel investors. And, you know, if you think about NASA and how they progressed and how they now had to go into the public sector, that's something that is, I think, a little bit I'm wary of, just because, but he's not in the private sector. He's now getting the money, so maybe he learned. But it is interesting because I think about how what Elon Musk has done with, you know, that NASA couldn't have done just by, like, getting the money and just doing it. So it seems like maybe that is what he's doing, and getting the money and slowly doing it. So maybe the combination will work out. It is fascinating. I'm excited to see it.
Yeah, and I like that it's goal-focused. Like, there is a very clear end game in mind. I'm curious to see if in the coming months what we hear more from this company are, like, proofs that they can do something with computers that human brains are very good at doing, but computers are bad at doing. So things like facial recognition, identifying images, things like that. Like, there are a handful of things. Language processing, for example, is another really hard one for computers that we're just not good at. And maybe part of the solution is just having more processing going on in parallel.
Yeah, I mean, a part of that is the Nuverse aspect of this, which is basically military-grade voice recognition for next generation computing. And basically what it's all about is being able to use voice as authentication, they say the most secure form of biometric authentication, even with tons of background noise and other kind of conversations happening in the background, other voices in the background, still being able to use this technology to be able to pull out your voice out of all of that noise and still know that, you know, without a shadow of a doubt, that is you, and authenticate you based around that.
That's interesting, because I'm wondering if people listening to this right now could tell the difference between you and I, Jill. I sometimes get that complaint when there are two females.
Like, yeah, we can tell
the difference. I know. Exactly. They're just all girls. Who cares?
You can unlock each other's phone. It's a neat trick.
Yeah. Oh, my.
So, okay. I'm a T-Mobile subscriber. Apparently I'm going to get a share of T-Mobile. Actually, I'm not, because I'm prepaid, but if you are a T-Mobile subscriber with a postpaid or a monthly account, T-Mobile is willing to make you, its loyal customer, a shareholder by offering you one share of the stock, which is currently trading at around $43 per share, if that matters. The plan is called Stock Up, and customers who take part won't have to pay for any charges normally associated with stock allocation. Basically, what this is part of their big Uncarrier event. Every year, T-Mobile has their Uncarrier event and rolls out things like last year it was Binge On with their video streaming, you know, with select partners that it wouldn't use any of your plan data usage. So this year they're making everybody stock owners, essentially. And you can also get a share for every person that you refer. And if you've been with T-Mobile for 5 years or more, you actually get two shares for all of those, up to 100 shares per year. Is this a big deal? Do people want shares of T-Mobile? I guess anything yeah. free is good, right?
Yeah, I want $43.07. Sure. And you forgot to say also he's giving free pizza.
Oh, well, that's another part of it. Go ahead. What do you think, Jill? Free pizza, is that good enough?
Somebody's got to get their, like, bleep button ready, because I'm just like, what is this? What is this insanity?
Yeah.
It just seems like, why are you trying to make me into a stock investor? I just want to use your product and or service.
Uh-huh.
It's just, it sounds loopy. I don't know. Maybe they're at their end of their, you know, their wit's end, and they're just going to experiment with some wacky concepts now. But it seems just so out there to me. I don't really understand it. So does that mean that if I get a share of this, I can sell it right away? Like, how does that work? Do I have to hold my share for the duration that I am a customer? I don't.
Yeah, you just have to be a customer for life. If you take that stock, then
yeah.
you can never go never, anywhere
else. Never, ever again.
Roaches come in and they don't
just
come
get
out.
It and just pass it out, and that's it. Like,
well, you know, it's not just the stock, all right? You're going to get pizza. You're going to get a Frosty. You're going to get...
The idea is, like, I hang on to my service for 5 years, and then 5 years from now, it's worth, like,
$49. Right.
And then I find that out, and I can never cash it in. And then probably what's going to happen is a whole bunch of people are going to die, and nobody's going to know that they own this stock, right? And it's going to just, like, sit around for... years and years. I don't know. This just seems like crazy to me.
Yeah, that's T-Mobile in a nutshell. They do crazy things like this. You can get ride shares. You can get a ticket to Warcraft in the movie theater. It's like a random jumble of things that you get, but free stuff.
Yeah,
there you go.
He says a lot of crazy stuff.
He does. That's kind of his
shtick. It's not like I'm giving Sprint stock, which is like worth 30 cents now. And like it is worth like $2 or something. It's not worth 30 cents. It's like, what? You know, you're a CEO of a company. Like, let's just get those numbers right at least a little bit. After the break, even Mark Zuckerberg can't help reusing passwords. But first, let's take a minute to thank Trunk Club, the sponsor of this episode. There are two types of men out there, only two. Guys who love shopping for clothes but are short on time, and those of you who hate it. Either way, take heart. Now you can get clothes that fit perfectly and look amazing without ever stepping into a store again, thanks to Trunk Club. Type in your measurements, share your likes and your dislikes, and your personal stylist will help you look and feel your best with clothes that fit you perfectly. Your stylist is professionally trained in all the brands Trunk Club offers, and there's so much more to Trunk Club than that. They'll pick clothes from over 80 top brands and ship them right to your door. Keep what you like, send back what you don't like. Your stylist takes the time to understand your unique look, and if you live in Dallas, New York, Los Angeles, Chicago, or DC, you can stop by one of the Trunk Club clubhouses to work with your stylist in person. And Trunk Club is not just for men. I use Trunk Club for some of the clothes I wear on this very show. The trunk is not always exactly right, but it is so easy to send things back that I don't like and keep the things that I do like. And because in general, many women are pickier than men, I was really surprised at how many things they did get right. Trunk Club is not a subscription service. Shipping is always free, and you have 10 days to try on the clothes. Make a statement at your next big event on the calendar with a look that's handpicked just for you and your style. Get started at Trunk Club today. Premium clothes, expert advice, no work, thanks to your very own personal stylist at Trunk Club. And Trunk Club is backed by Nordstrom's, which means they have the highest standards in quality and customer service. Get started today at trunkclub.com/TNT. That's trunkclub.com/TNT. And we thank them for their support.
All right. This next segment is called See, Billionaire CEOs Are People Too, Just Like You and Me. It turns out Mark Zuckerberg, CEO of Facebook, does what I'm sure many of those watching and listening today are guilty of, at least to some degree, and that's reusing passwords. Over the weekend, Zuckerberg's Twitter and Pinterest accounts were hacked by the Our Mind team, a hacking team. They say it was thanks to the recent LinkedIn password dump just a few weeks back, and that was based on old data, by the way. So then, Jill, if this can happen to Zuckerberg, no one is safe. How do we protect ourselves?
Okay, so the premise of your question, I'm going to say it's backwards.
Okay.
It's not that, oh, it can happen to him, it can happen to me. It's that it can happen to anybody, but he is somebody who was specifically targeted because he's a big deal.
Yeah.
This group went after him to make an example out of him because we would all pay attention if it was Zuckerberg. If I got hacked, nobody would care. Nobody would care. I would care because I would probably lose some money or something, right? Like a hacker is always in it for a motive. There's no reason to hack me unless you can get my credit card number, my social security number, something that you can make value off of. So celebrities are good targets because we can make value off of them in other ways. In this case, this group, are they called Our Time? Is that what they were called?
Yeah. Yeah, it's Our Mind team.
Our Mind.
Yeah.
They have something to gain because they get a lot of promotion and they make this case that they were able to hack him, right? So they're drawing attention to themselves in addition to drawing attention to Zuckerberg and the LinkedIn leak. So that being said, what's important to remember is that anybody can be hacked. But if you are not somebody, you know, if somebody can't make a gain off of you, you're less likely to be hacked. So in these hacks, people are usually trying to get passwords because they know that passwords are reused. And if they can get the password to your email, they can probably unlock things like your bank accounts, or other sources of finance, right? That's usually what they're going for, but there are other ways to make value. People are reusing passwords and they really, really shouldn't, because that's a easy way for things to get hacked. If you get into one, you can get into many. The very simplest solution to this is to not use the same password for anything else. So we were talking about AI earlier. Creating a long list of unique passwords for all of these different sites and remembering them is something that humans are very bad at and computers are very good at. So this is a job we need to leave to the computers, and the solution is just to get a good password manager. So a password manager lives on your computer or your smartphone or all of your devices, and it automatically saves and or creates unique passwords for all of the sites that you have that you log into. It also helps if you have a unique username that gives you another layer of protection. So LastPass is a very good example of a strong, reliable password manager. I use Dashlane. It's another very, very good one. But all these things do are help you manage all of your passwords so that you don't ever have to think about it. You don't have to remember them. And usually you don't even have to type them. So it's a little bit of a productivity booster too, because they log you in automatically once you log into your password manager. Everybody should be using them. If you think you don't want to afford it, just think of everything you could lose if you do get hacked or if your password is leaked. Many of them are free or have some free level of service. Absolutely, everybody should use a password manager.
Absolutely agree. I use LastPass and have been really into that for the last couple of years. I think the common like fear that people have when they start up with one of these things is, I have to get it all set up and put all my passwords in there or whatever. But the reality is you set it up and you let it just kind of work as you use your computer normally from that point forward, right? So the first time you log into eBay, it will capture that, and you don't have to like go out of your way to log into eBay. It's just the next time you do, it'll capture that information and now it's part of the system going forward.
Right, and a very good password manager will look and compare all of the passwords that it has collected, and it will say, hey, Jill, you've reused this password in 5 different places, so you should really change it. Would you like me to change it for you? I'll create a very long, complex, difficult to break password for you. And then you say yes, and it just does it. So I wrote this article a few years ago called How I Cleaned Up My Password in 5 Weeks. I think at the time I had a little over 200 different passwords. I test a lot of software. I create logins for just about everything. And I had so many passwords, I didn't know what to do with them. So I started using Dashlane a little bit earlier in the process. And Dashlane has since come out with this new feature that automatically can change passwords for you. So not only is it detecting when they're weak and creating a strong one, but it'll actually go into the system. So, you know, a site like LinkedIn and just change it and update it for you. You have to do very, very little. It gives you a security score so you can see if you are generally pretty weak online and subject to being hacked, or if you have a pretty strong online profile overall. This, when I did it, the automated feature wasn't in place yet, and that's why it took me 5 weeks. So the point of the article was really like, if you have a big complex project like updating 250 passwords, you can compartmentalize it, break it down, and accomplish it over a number of weeks. I think I did like 10 or 15 of them every 2 or 3 days. I don't remember exactly. But now I could get through a project like that in probably like 2 days. So I'd let it do all of the ones it could automate, and then I'd have to clean up another, you know, dozen or two dozen by hand just because they're not supported by the online automated system.
Yeah, the LastPass has that as well. I was actually working with it this morning because I've been doing something similar to what you're talking about here over the past couple of weeks, where when I think about it and I'm working, I just kind of have it open and kind of go through and change passwords on things if I have some duplicates somewhere or whatever. I'm just trying to get it all, you know, straightened away. I think I have somewhere around like 500 or 600 passwords. So it's no small task, you know, no matter how you slice it, that takes a lot of time and it's super daunting. But just little by little, piece by piece, the automated system for me does not work half the time. Like, and I don't know if it's because their system, you know, like LastPass, for example, they probably have a script that understands, you know, step by step what a site does when you set up a password, logs in, takes you to this page, click on this link, take you to that page, that sort of stuff. And I don't think all the time it's purely up to date, but it's better than nothing, at least to get you started.
Yeah, and when I was updating my passwords, like I would think about, well, what are the most important ones that I should make sure are strong first, right? So all of my bank accounts, all of my email accounts, done. Like, let's get those out of the way first. And then everything else that is like a big name company. So I worried less about the little app that I signed up for once, and I focused more on the big stuff that I use all the time that has important information in it. So if it could unlock my bank account, if it had my credit card details saved anywhere. Like, that's the kind of stuff that I paid attention to first. And then I took care of everything else little by little. And the nice thing about a password manager is once you have it set up, any new accounts that you create will always have a strong login, always have a strong password. The final thing I really want to say about password managers is a very good one will not be able to help you out if you ever forget the password to the password manager. So the reason is a good password manager company will never store your password for the password manager on its servers. So the idea with them is that you create one strong password that you will memorize, or maybe you'll write it down and like stick it in your pillowcase or something. I don't know. But that password is the one you have to know and you can't forget, because if you lose it, you got to start completely over. They can't help you out. And if you find a password manager company that offers this ability to reset the password for the password manager, it's probably not the best password manager.
All right, that's good advice. I love your organization advice and your tips. It's like saved me. I think you've probably added, I don't know, weeks to my life, Jill. Thank you.
Good to hear it.
And taken away weeks for all the amount of time that it's going to take for you to do all of this with a password manager.
Right, exactly. No, but then eventually I'll save time.
Eventually, yes. The long game.
So we got an email last week. We talked about how The Sims will now let female characters wear men's clothes and the other way around. And I asked, what took them so long? Jennifer, a longtime gamer and game programmer, wrote in. She said, the show 1526 covered some gaming stories, and it seemed like there was a fundamental misunderstanding about The Sims and the changes they made. The Sims is highly moddable and has a vibrant community of people who make outfits, items, houses, hairstyles, and just about anything you can think of for your Sims. There was never a time that a female Sim couldn't wear a tuxedo. You just had to download it from one of the many fan sites. What The Sims has done in the past can be compared to going to any clothing store. They make a garment and hang it in either the women's or the men's department. And as for asking why they haven't done away with that already, well, why hasn't every clothing and accessory store done that at the real mall? However, The Sims is doing much more than removing the gender signs from their clothes. They're letting female Sims have previously male voice ranges. They're letting male characters have walking animations that were previously for females. To me, the most significant was the change to allow Sims to change their gender during their lifetime. Just removing the idea that you're stuck with the gender you're born with challenges many people's perceptions of the issue. It also felt like a big miss, not to mention that The Sims has been slightly ahead of the curve on inclusion since its launch. In 2000, it allowed same-sex relationships, including the concept that all Sims are inherently bisexual. And later, it allowed for same-sex marriage. At 37 and being a girl gamer, I've watched a lot of changes in the gaming community for good and bad. But one thing I truly believe is that steps taken to increase inclusivity in something that is so much fun and can truly be inspiring shouldn't be downplayed. Thank you, Jennifer. So I don't know if you followed The Sims, if you were a Sims player, Jill, at all. But this was an interesting story. I don't know. Did you see it at all last week?
A little bit, yeah. I'm on board with y'all. It's why did it take them so long? There's an old Eddie Izzard skit about somebody says to him, "Why are you wearing women's dresses?" And he's like, "These aren't some woman's dresses. These are my dresses. Like, they're just clothes." Yeah, and I think the idea of inclusion is not just about like, oh, people have to be straight or bisexual or gay, but like women can just be not so classically quote-unquote feminine looking. Like there is a range of people in human experience, and you know, when you program something, I guess you do have to work within rules and you have to create structure. That's what programming is all about. It's been a problem in the game community for a long, 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 long time. It will probably continue to be in a lot of ways, but this is a good move for The Sims. Yeah, long overdue.
Well, Jill, it was a pleasure to have you on the show. You are a contributing editor at PC Magazine. Is there anything that you've worked on recently that you would like us to point people to?
Yeah, I've been writing a couple of articles for Fast Company, mostly about productivity and productivity research. And last year, I launched a new blog called productivityreport.org, which also has more geeky productivity research. So I'm looking at what do the researchers know about things that make us more or less productive. And I'm kind of questioning, why aren't we looking more at that research? Why are we listening to so many self-professed gurus and CEOs? So I want to look at facts, I want to look at data, and I think that can help us live our lives a little better.
Awesome. I'm for shorter or no meetings, absolutely.
I like the sound of that.
Thank you, Jill.
Thank you, Jill.
Jill E. Duffy on Twitter. Thanks so much for joining us.
All right. Thanks for having me, guys.
Take care.
All right. Have a good night. All right, coming up, WWDC is right around the corner, and Mike Murphy from Quartz has a nice roundup of what we might see there, looking into the future a little bit. But first, let's take a minute to thank Blue Apron, the sponsor of this episode. Blue Apron's mission is to make incredible home cooking accessible to everyone, while also supporting a more sustainable food system, setting the highest standards for ingredients, and building a community of home chefs. For less than $10 per serving, Blue Apron delivers seasonal recipes along with fresh, high-quality ingredients to make delicious home-cooked meals. Every meal comes with a step-by-step, easy-to-follow recipe card, pre-portioned ingredients in the box that can be prepared in 40 minutes or less. You can customize your recipes every week based on your dietary preferences. You can also choose a delivery option that works for your schedule. There's no weekly commitment, so you only get deliveries when you actually want them. Blue Apron delivers to 99% of the continental U.S., sets the highest quality standards for their community of over 150 local farms, fisheries, and ranchers across the U.S. Seafood is sourced sustainably, but beef is raised humanely. Chickens are free-range, pork is raised naturally, and regenerative farming practices are used for produce. By shipping the exact amount required for every recipe, Blue Apron actually reduces food waste as well, so you get exactly what you need to do that recipe. It's perfect. Whether it's Japanese ramen noodles, wild-caught Alaskan salmon, or heirloom tomatoes, Blue Apron brings you the best. Not only supports a more sustainable food system, it supports happy and healthy families. Cooking together, of course, builds strong family bonds, and research shows that Blue Apron families cook nearly three times more often. New recipes are created every week by Blue Apron's team, and they're not repeated within a year, so you're always getting something new, something fresh to check out. You can cook meals like spicy Korean rice cakes with snow peas and pea shoots, or New England-style salmon rolls with roasted potatoes and chives, and it's obviously time for dinner. Check out this week's menu and get your first two meals free with free shipping by going to blueapron.com/twit. You'll love how good it feels and tastes to create incredible home-cooked meals with Blue Apron, so do not wait. Check it out for yourself. Visit blueapron.com/twit. We thank Blue Apron for their support of Tech News Today. Blue Apron, a better way to cook.
Apple's Worldwide Developers Conference is coming up next week, and the world is buzzing with excitement. Or are they? Some say Apple. You're buzzing with excitement? You're faking
that. I feel like
that.
There's a fly flying around here.
Now, some people are saying that Apple's getting a little bit boring, so they're sitting on a $230 billion pile of cash. Yawn. They've been fighting with the FBI. That's over. Newer, bigger, smaller iPhones. What do we want? Here to talk to us about what Apple has really been up to is Mike Murphy from Quartz. Welcome, Mike.
Hey, guys. How are you?
We're doing well. Okay, so the conference is coming up. You say the biggest thing they're working on is their new building that's shaped like a spaceship. Tell us about that.
Yeah, I mean, that's literally the biggest thing that we can see that they're working on, that's for sure.
From space.
So, yeah, there was some new, like, drone footage that was shot, I think it was last week, showing the progress. And it's the $5 billion building seems to be coming along pretty nicely. But, I mean, other than that, there doesn't seem to be too many new products on the near horizon. And we can't really all enjoy that campus like they can.
But you said that they're spending a lot of money on R&D, so they must be working on something. Any ideas?
I mean, yeah, that's what you'd hope. I don't know what else you would do with R&D money, I guess. but, yeah, I mean, Apple has been making a lot of hires for years now in areas that everyone keeps criticizing them for being behind in, whether that's virtual assistants or artificial intelligence or transportation. They have been doing a lot of work kind of behind the scenes in a lot of that stuff. I mean, I just found today that there are 96 job openings for Apple that mention artificial intelligence or machine learning. I mean, that doesn't sound like a company that isn't interested in that sort of thing, to me, at least.
Yeah, I mean, we were just talking earlier about New Edge, that new project by the guy from NASA. We were speaking to Jill Duffy, and she pointed out that, you know, it's nice to see somebody spending a decade on something rather than just like, oh, we need it now, right now. And Apple is more on the side, other than, like, aside from Google, as opposed to Google, they are kind of, they do work on things more slowly, not out in the open. So, I mean, what do you think they're going to do with this AI? Do you think it's going to be like an Amazon Echo competitor?
I think that's a really fair point that they, you know, they don't rush to market. They make sure their stuff usually is pretty good when it gets out there. I've seen talk, and you know, it's kind of hard to bet against Mark Gurman and everything that he reports. And there seems to have been talk that there's going to be some sort of like, you know, Echo-esque, Google Home-esque thing announced sometime soon. I think The Information reported that it might even show up at WWDC, though Mark Gurman was saying that there's going to be no hardware at WWDC. That seems to me more like a kind of stopgappy thing, a kind of Me Too thing. I mean, even if it's awesome, I think that Apple will probably try and go for grander things. That could well just be an extension of the work that they've done with Siri for years now. And I do think there's something bigger in the pipeline. I kind of speculated a little bit in my piece today, but I mean, it could well be somewhere between self-driving cars and robotics in other aspects. I mean, as I said, you know, you don't look to hire almost 100 people just to make your recycling robot a little better, or just to make your Amazon Echo a little better. I do think that there is something bigger in the works, and that R&D money would seem to suggest that too.
But you don't mean something, they're going to announce a car at WWDC. That's not what you're saying.
No, I definitely don't think that's going to happen. I honestly, I would be surprised. I mean, I know we've kind of been hung up on this car for like, I think a year now, or it feels like a year. I'll be surprised if it happens sooner rather than later, honestly, because it's a car. I mean, it's not like something you can have a beta version of, or something that, you know, you can bring back and swap out like a phone if it's a little bit defective. You know, auto grade parts are not quite as, or are far more involved and far more durable than your average consumer electronic good. So I do think that they probably have a little while longer to go before that car comes out. But I don't know. I think that there's probably going to be something bigger at the end of the year. And from what others have said, it looks like 2017 is going to be a banner year for the company.
Yeah, not to mention WWDC is a developer conference. I'd be surprised just in general if they ever do have some sort of a car announcement or whatever. Like, it just doesn't make a whole lot of sense that it would appear on the stage at WWDC unless developers can program the dash for users, which I highly doubt. What about VR? Because, I mean, it seems like VR, you know, obviously it's a big trend this year. We've heard little things here and there about Apple's VR efforts. Google at Google I.O., you know, basically just showed that VR is built into Android at this point going forward. Any expectations around Apple?
Again, I'd be surprised if there was anything at WWDC, but Apple has a ton of patents on, mm-hmm. on VR and AR related stuff. They have over 200 that they've been awarded, not just applied for. And I do think there probably will be something eventually again, but I wrote a piece relatively recently about why I don't think Apple will or should get into the VR industry anytime soon. And that's kind of because, I don't know, this might just be my opinion, but Google Cardboard and Samsung Gear VR are like okay at best for a few minutes. And the user experience of things like the Vive and the Rift aren't that great. The games are great, but the actual kind of going through the machinations of setting everything up and kind of finding games, making sure everything works, troubleshooting, all that kind of stuff is a real hassle right now. And Apple doesn't tend to like stuff that's a real hassle. You know, they want stuff that my mom can use in 8 seconds, not something like, you know, an IT guy has to sit there and like troubleshoot. So unless they've got something crazy, unless they're even better than Magic Leap, whatever Magic Leap's doing, I do think it's going to be a while before we see kind of a true VR system. But again, I mean, it could well be that there's some sort of AR thing. I mean, the iPhone was the original platform for augmented reality. You look at companies like Blipper, they've been doing it for years. So who knows what there might actually be something there in the phone itself sooner rather than later.
Well, Mike, thank you so much for joining us. You cover robots better than a robot would, for sure. For now.
At least until all that like neural robot stuff we were talking about earlier happens. Yeah. And then robots are going to be smarter than you. But until then, you are smarter than robots.
Right, right.
Thank you.
Mike Murphy is a reporter at Quartz, and he is MCWM on Twitter. Thanks so much for coming on.
Yes.
There's your robot overlord right there.
Yeah.
Take care, Mike.
Thank you, Mike. Bye. We'll talk to you soon. All right, TNT's fan of the day is this guy. His name's Greg Burnett. He's the guy who often runs our prompter on many days. He says he always has, quote, the best seat in the house. That's what it looks like from his seat. Mm-hmm. A little text in front, so he gets a little preview of what we're about to talk about. Maybe that's the benefit there. As long as he can stay seated in that seat and not end up on the floor, I believe him. Show us how you watch or listen to TNT. Just record a video or take a picture of yourself or your setup and post it on Instagram, Google+, Twitter, or Facebook, and use the hashtag #HowIWatchTNT, and we'll find it.
Up next, the ups and downs of crowdfunding human gills. That's right, I said human gills. But first, let's take a minute to thank PillPack, the sponsor of this episode. This episode of Tech News Today is brought to you by PillPack, a full-service online pharmacy that will make you wonder why you ever settled for a traditional pharmacy. With PillPack, you'll never have to wait around for your prescriptions, sort your own pills, or chase down your doctors for refills again. The pharmacists take care of everything for you. PillPack uses advanced technology to sort all of your medications and vitamins by the date and time for each dose. You can also order inhalers, creams, and diabetes supplies, which come in refrigerated, easy-to-open packages. Shipping is always free. Their pharmacists are available 24/7 so that you can speak with them from the privacy of your own home or if you're on the go. PillPack has truly designed their pharmacy to make your life easier and have very quickly disrupted the pharmacy industry. What's great is that PillPack is compatible with most major insurance plans, including most forms of Medicare Part D, and their service is free. That means you only pay the copays set by your insurance provider. Here's what I want you to do. Visit pillpack.com/twit to sign up now. It only takes 5 minutes to get started. And when you use our link and you transfer your prescriptions to PillPack, you'll get a credit for $20 worth of vitamins and OTCs. That's pillpack.com/TWIT.
All right, so an entrepreneur in Sweden did what the rest of us never could do, and he went to Indiegogo to fund his idea of creating human gills so we can breathe underwater. We all wanted to do that, right? He scored more than $800,000 in the process. The problem was, as is the case with many crowdfunded miracles, it was never apparent that those running the campaign could actually deliver on the promise of pulling enough oxygen from the water to enable a person to breathe. Ultimately, the Triton campaign was canceled by Indiegogo, returning all money to the backers. But it kind of points to the ongoing concern for crowdfunding. Are we paying for a product or are we supporting an idea? And who out there is running a campaign simply to rip people off in the end? We've also heard of the saga of Peachy Printer, which is another example from last month where they finished and one of the there were two of them running the campaign. One of them took a bunch of money, talking like $300,000 and built a house with it without the other guy knowing.
You thought I was going to build you a printer? I meant I was going to build me a house.
Yeah, it was kind of a crazy deal. But I don't know. You know, often we hear stories about this, and I think every time we hear this sort of thing, it kind of like it hurts just the thought of crowdfunding. Because it damages kind of the long-term viability of crowdfunding as a platform for products, I think. And there's a lot of people that get into this with a great idea, but the reality is they don't necessarily know how to do, all of the complexities of running a business to create a product, a hardware product. Hardware's hard. We hear that all the time. So I don't know. It points out a lot of recurring issues with just crowdfunding in general.
Yeah, I mean, it's unclear here whether they were on purpose being fraudulent or really mm-hmm. thought they could figure out the technology. But they were. I mean, it's been proven that they were showing a video, not of a working product. You know, it was like, oh, you can breathe, but just by chewing this thing, and you can breathe for a really long time. But the video itself that we're looking at now, like, it was never shot. You know, it's never shot. You're never watching them breathe for that long. long underwater in one single shot. It was a little bit fake. So it says maximum 45 minutes. Obviously, we weren't watching that 45-minute YouTube video. I picked this story specifically because one of the 11-year-olds who lives in my home brought this video to me. He was like, you have to see this product, and we have got to back it. It's amazing, and you can breathe underwater, and I want it right now. And he was like, let's buy this. And it was a nice teachable moment because I was like, okay, you're not buying something, you know, when you crowdfund something. I mean, it's great. It's great when a kid wants to, like, support an idea and put their allowance to something, but you have to tell them, you know, you're not buying this. You don't know. And I was, even that, I was like, that looks a little suspicious. Like, I wouldn't want you to be, like, down under the water and then all of a sudden it not work. But yeah, I think with most things, like, most people are good in the world. That's what I believe. And like you said, I think that some people just can't get it together to actually get the product out. They didn't intend to be fraudulent. Mm-hmm. That's what I think.
It's one thing to have a great idea and to think that the science, let's say, is in your favor. It's another thing to execute it. I mean, a device like this is no small feat, you know. Just put this tiny little device in your mouth and it takes the oxygen out of the water that's already there and converts it into breathable oxygen, you know. And, like, that would be a huge deal.
Yeah.
But yet the Triton team, hours after that first campaign was canceled and refunded, they started a new campaign and they posted a 15-minute video this time of someone underwater using it. But again, it was a fixed camera position. Uh-huh. There was no kind of like going around, you know. Yeah. there were enough questions, and I guess the Indiegogo the staffers at Indiegogo contacted them after that campaign had closed with something like $400,000, you know, backed on that one, and the Triton team was not able to necessarily answer their questions in a way that they felt comfortable saying, yes, this is, you know, this could possibly happen. And so they, again, refunded the money. Mm-hmm. So at least there's some form of protection there. There's no real regulation around this. So that's where things get kind of iffy, you know, because literally anyone can start a crowdfunding campaign, and people are really good at doing things like editing flashy videos that capture your imagination and creating, you know, bubbly flow charts, you know, that people can look at and get really excited about this concept. So yeah, it's a little bit of a challenge. The market for this type of stuff, crowdfunding, has exploded as well. Like in 2010, it was an $880 million market. Now, 2015, $34 billion market. So there's a ton of money here. So it's guaranteed that there are frauds in there as
even
well.
Even though most people in the world are good.
Yes. Even though, as Megan claims, most people in the world are good.
So in a way, like, this is one of those tech stories that is not new. Because, I mean, if you've ever had an uncle or a cousin or a friend of a friend of a friend who is an inventor, and it's like, I made this product and it's going to sell billions and it does this and this, and, you know, can you help me? You know, I think that's been going on in families and friend groups way before the internet. And there were a lot of broken dreams there too, like that, sure. You know, and almost you think, oh, well, at least it's strangers that you're, you know, pissing off as opposed to your family members.
Yeah.
So, I mean, you could look at it that way.
I mean, worst case scenario, when you're talking about crowdfunding, don't think of it as buying something in advance, which gets a little confusing too, because you have companies like Pebble that literally use crowdfunding platforms as pre-order machines. Mm-hmm. And so then it kind of trains us to think of it that way. But by and large, just think of it as like what you're doing is funding an idea, whether that idea turns into anything or not. Like, you have to be okay when you give that. It's kind of like going to Vegas and playing the slots. Mm-hmm. You've got to be okay with the fact that you might never see that money again. And maybe you'll win. Maybe you will see something. And if you do, oftentimes it takes a really long time. So yeah, was it your kid or a friend? Okay.
I said
they would have waited a long time. You know?
Right. They
that would have been a big bummer.
Right.
Like,
yes, to use your allowance
at the
on
very
that.
Least.
Yeah. And I think there's one, to Jill's point before about how we want everything right now. And I think sometimes it's not, I mean, I think sometimes the products come out, it's just too late. It's just like, it's months after it was promised. Or even, you know, I funded the $9 computer, I think, and it was over a year ago. And I guess I knew that. I don't think they missed their date, but it's been so long that it does feel like a little bit of a letdown. Like, yeah. Especially with something like that. I mean, now there's a $4 computer. Like, it was a big deal then.
$4?
I know. So I think sometimes it's our own expectations and our own demands to get things so fast. And, you know, we don't read the fine print that says, you know, I mean, I'm super excited. Yep, there's the chip. Mine is in the mail now, but I think it's been a long time since I funded it. And I'm excited to get it still, but I'm less excited than if I had gotten it immediately, in which, you know, the manner to which I'm accustomed to.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Different scenario entirely. All right. Tomorrow's guest will be Brad Sams, the executive editor of, is it Petri.com? Mm-hmm. I want to say Petri, but I knew that's probably not right. Anthrot.com. So it'll be great to have Brad on. TNT records live every Monday through Friday at 4 p.m. Pacific, 7 p.m. Eastern, 12 a.m. UTC at twit.tv/live. You can take part in the show by emailing us. That's tnt@twit.tv. You can also leave us a short voicemail at 260-TNT-SHOW and find us on Twitter. We're at TechNewsTodayTV.
And if you've gotten this far, I am guessing that you have already subscribed to our show. And if not, you know how to subscribe. So send a friend to twit.tv/TNT. Tell them, show them how to subscribe. And if you want to tweet at me, I am at Megan Morrone.
We aren't going to award you a share of stock for every referral that you give for subscribing to Twit.
Nor will we give you pizza.
Yeah. Well, unless you come into the studio and we happen to be ordering pizza, we'll give you a slice.
But Brian will rain down money like that.
Which is almost as good as the real thing. Almost. I'm at Jason Howell on Twitter. Thanks to our technical director, Brian Burnett, and all the folks who help us produce this show every single day. And thanks to you for talking tech with us today. We'll see you all tomorrow. Bye, everyone. Bye.